100 sinus omega t times the newton meter. All right, so let's start on this. If you go to table 820, you can find the mechanical properties of the material. And so the ultimate tensile strength is 400 megapascal, and the yield stress is 220 megapascal. This is a dynamic loading problem, so we know that we do dynamic loading problems, we always have to calculate the endurance limit. The way we start out the problems like that is we first calculate sigma e prime, the endurance limit of the Mohr specimen for this particular material, and then we calculate our endurance limit modifying factors to convert sigma e prime to sigma e. So let's start from sigma e prime. Sigma e prime is half of the ultimate tensile strength as long as the tensile strength is smaller than 1400 megapascal. So in this case, it's going to be 0.5 times 400 is 200 megapascal. Then we have to calculate our endurance limit modifying factors. So let's see what kind of information do we have here. Because the ones that we don't have information about, we are going to set to 1. So we don't have any information about temperature. We don't have any information about reliability or miscellaneous effects. And we're going to, this is the case of combined loading. And in cases of combined loading, we always set the loading factor Kc equal to 1. So the one that we, the parameters that we have knowledge about are just the surface quality and the dimension. And since this is a verification calculation, we're asked to calculate a factor of safety, we can calculate Kb, right? Because the diameter is given. So let's calculate those parameters here. Ka is going to be equal to A times sigma ut to the power of B. And so it's hot rolled and ground. Which one do we pick?
Ground.
Ground. So we always take the final operation on the shaft. And so we have 1.58 for A. We plug in the ultimate tensile strength in megapascal because this is a empirical formula. So sigma ut is 400, and then b, the same line, minus 0.085. So this is equal to 0.95. You'd expect a number close to 1 here because ground is a very fine surface finish. It's very close to polish, which is the surface finish of the Mohr specimen. So the difference in surface quality between the actual Mohr specimen, standardized specimen, and this mechanical element is minute, and that's reflected in that Ka factor that is very close to 1, right? If it were to be a Mohr specimen, it would be equal to 1. So this is very similar. The second parameter is Kb, and that reflects how different the geometry of that shaft is from the Mohr specimen. And again, we go to our table. This is a circular cross-section rotating shaft. We don't have to calculate an equivalent diameter. It's 40 millimeters in diameter, so it falls in between these two limits here, so we can use that equation. 1.24. And then D is plugged in millimeters, so this is 40. Power minus 0.107. That is 0.836. And all the other parameters, and there was limit modifying factors, we can set to 1 because we don't have any specific information about that. You Again, the loading factor KC is equal to 1 because it's combined loading. It's neither pure axial loading nor pure torsion loading. So now we can calculate sigma E. It's KA, KB, sigma E. So we got 0.95 and 0.836 times sigma E prime. That gives us 158.84 megapascals. Let's now take a look at our shaft again. Our shaft is represented as a line here. What I want to do is I want to draw the moment diagram. And I also want to draw the torque moment diagram. And so the shaft has a little F here in the middle. Okay, so what is our moment diagram going to look like? What's the shape of the geometric shape of the moment diagram for this type of situation?
Sinusoidal.
What?
It's
a triangle, right? No, it's zero at the sinusoid. No, a triangle, right? So
yeah. Zero at the ends and then peak at the middle.
Correct. So it's a pin joint on the sides. The bearings, right, are pin joints always. The reason why we can consider that pin joints is because most of these bearings are a little bit self-aligning. Right, so if you have a little bit of misalignment, these bearings are going to slightly rotate, or the shaft is going to rotate with respect to the races. And so that's a pin joint. Here you got a load in the middle, and then your moment diagram is going to look like a triangle. And what is our maximum moment going to be? Our maximum moment is going to be the reaction force times the maximum leverage arm, right? What is the reaction force in each of the bearings? 1,000 newton. And what's the maximum leverage arm? Well, that's half of the length of the shaft, so that is 0.5 meters. So this is going to be 1,000 and 0.5 is 500 newton meters. Okay, so now let's take a look at our torque moment diagram. What does the torque moment diagram look like through the shaft?
Sinusoidal.
It must be constant, right?
It's going to be bar
up. If I apply a torque on one side, and I were to have a torque sensor, and I put that torque sensor at any point through my shaft, I'm going to measure the same torque throughout my shaft. Now, the magnitude of the torque is going to change sinusoidally. That's correct. But we're interested in what is the maximum torque amplitude here, because that's what we're going to base our calculations on. So this is going to be a constant where our maximum torque moment is going to be equal to 100 newton meters. Right? So the idea there is if this is my shaft here, this piece of chalk, and I'm torquing it on one side, and I have this tiny torque sensor that I can measure the torque with anywhere I want, I'm going to measure exactly the torque that I'm applying on this side. There's nothing along this shaft that will change the torque that I'm applying, and hence it needs to be constant throughout the entire shaft. So, to solve this problem, it wasn't particularly needed to draw these diagrams, but I draw it because I think it's good practice to do. And because we've never even specified, before we started this problem, the question was, determine the factor of safety against fatigue failure, okay, for infinite fatigue leverage. But we did not specify where in the shaft. Of course, we would be calculating it where you would expect it to break first, right? And so to find that spot, to find the cross-section of the shaft where it is going to fail as a result of dynamic loading, as a result of fatigue, it's interesting to draw these diagrams, and it's good practice to do that because you see right away where the maximum load is going to be in this case. It's going to be right in the center where your bending moment is maximum, because there you're going to have maximum normal stress resulting from the bending moment. Your torque moment itself is going to create a shear stress, but that is not going to impact where it's going to fail because it's constant throughout the entire shaft. So it's really the bending moment that is going to determine where the failure is going to occur. Right? So obviously, failure is going to occur right here, right in the middle. And when we have more complex loading cases, this may not be as straightforward, but you can always determine from your moment diagrams and or internal force diagrams where failure is going to occur. Yeah.
Speak up.
Why don't
the maximum is 1,000
times divided by 2,000? Well, you're that's a common mistake, right? So you want to find your reaction forces here in the bearings. They're going to be 1,000 because it's symmetric, and then it's this force times the electron that determines your moment. Because if you make a cut in your shaft and you try to find your moment, then you calculate, you know, moment is equal to this load times x, whatever that distance is, right? And so for a setup like this, a symmetric setup, the maximum moment is going to be the force times the length of the shaft divided by 4, right? And that stems from this f over 2 times l over 2, which gives you fl over 4. So write that down because that's one of the most common mistakes that people make. Okay, so let's take a look here at our loading situation now, right? We have a bending moment. What kind of stress is this bending moment going to generate? A normal stress, right? What type of stress is this torque moment going to generate? Shear stress. So there's two stress components that we're going to need to calculate here. Now, this normal stress here, is that going to be a steady stress or is that going to be an alternating stress?
Steady.
Alternating because the shaft is rotating. Remember the example that we gave, if you glue yourself as an observer to the surface of the shaft, the force is constant, but you as an observer see compression and tension in an alternating fashion, right? So this is going to be an alternating stress component, normal stress. We're going to call that sigma A, an alternating normal stress. And then the torque moment is of course going to result in an alternating or steady shear stress.
No, that's steady.
Who says alternating? Who says steady? It's alternating, right? Because you got the sinus omega t, right? So there's no doubt here. The torque moment is alternating, and an alternating torque moment for sure is going to result in an alternating stress component. Okay, so now that we know what we're dealing with, we can calculate these stresses here, and so we can say the alternating stress component is going to be the maximum moment times the maximum distance from the neutral line. What's that going to be in this case?
D over 2.
And then we need to divide it by the appropriate moment of inertia. Remember, moment of inertia physically is, in the case of bending, a resistance against bending. So which moment of inertia are we calculating? We're calculating the moment of inertia of this cross-section around the neutral axis, right? Let's call it OO, because that's the area moment of inertia that resists bending. So in this case, that is going to be pi e to the power of 4 divided by
64.
And so we can simplify this equation. The d can go, right? And so we got m max, and then the 64 and the 32, and 64 and the 2 give us 32 divided by pi d to the power of 3. Now we can plug in numbers, 32. times the maximum moment plus 500 newton meters, and then pi times 0.040 power 3, and that gives us 79.36 megapascals. So That's the normal stress resulting from bending. The maximum normal stress resulting from bending. The torque is going to give us an alternating shear stress, and that is going to be equal to mt times the maximum distance from the neutral axis, which is now orthogonal to the blackboard. That's again going to be d over 2. But now the resistance against torque is not the area moment of inertia around the neutral axis, it's going to be the polar moment of inertia, which is double this one. So we have pi times d to the power 4 divided by 32. So torque, the shear stress then reduces to 16 times mt divided by pi d cubed. And so 16 times 100 divided by pi. So this is a combined loading case. We're dealing with shear stress and normal stress. Luckily, both of them are alternating, so both of them are dynamic stresses. After we're done with this example, we'll learn how to deal with what if you have a steady stress component and an alternating stress component. We haven't talked about that yet. Those are fluctuating stresses. Remember, these are alternating stresses. But we need to find a way to sort of summarize, for lack of a better word, I always use summarize these two stress components into one equivalent stress that we can compare to our sigma e that we just calculated, right? And so how do we do that? Well, this is a ductile material, so we can just use the von Mises failure criterion to calculate an equivalent stress. We're going to call sigma a equivalent, or let's actually call it sigma a prime, which is what we're going to be using for the remainder of the course. And so the prime refers to the equivalent stress. And let's define it right here. It's equal to sigma a squared plus 3 times tau a squared to the power 1/2. And so this is just applying our von Mises failure criteria to combine these two stress components into one stress component, which we then can compare to our endurance limit. So we can do this 79.36 squared plus 3 times 7.97 squared. And that gives us 80.55. And now the last step is straightforward. We were asked to calculate the safety factor against fatigue failure for infinite fatigue life. So let's write out what that safety factor is. Our safety factor always is the loss of function parameter, which in this case is what? Sigma e, the endurance limit for infinite fatigue life. Sorry, endurance limit is always for infinite fatigue life. And then the maximum stress occurring in the design is going to be what? Sigma A prime, which is our equivalent alternating normal stress that damages our material, if you will, our shaft, as much as the individual stress components would do. Right? So sigma A prime causes as much fatigue damage to your shaft than the individual application of sigma A and tau A at the same time. That's what sigma A means, or sigma A prime means, physically. So then we just need to calculate these ratios. So sigma E is 158.54 megapascal, and sigma A prime is 80.55 megapascal. So that gives us a safety factor of 2.73.